Hi, everyone. So we're here. Today is December 9th, 2021. We're here with Jonathan. It's his first ever couple that he's going to be seeing. Jonathan's one of our practicum students at Ofir Counseling. And Jonathan, if you can give a little bit of background about your couple from whatever you know. I know you haven't seen them yet, but yeah, anything you'd like to share before we start?
Their intake is pretty bare. It says communication problems and then that's it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I really don't have much in terms of background to share about.
Good. That's actually good because that first session of yours is essentially going to be broken up into, I believe, 30 minutes with one partner, 30 minutes with the other, and then 30 minutes together. Is that correct? Or is it a different setup for you?
So I was looking online and from what I read, some places said just do the first session together and then get them both on track, like on the same page about how like EFT will look. Mm-hmm. And then do individual sessions in the second or third session.
Right. What I meant more as in like this, for, I don't know if I booked this or Liam booked it, but how was it booked? Is it an hour session or is it a 90 minute
session? It's an hour session.
Okay. Yeah. So in that case, and it doesn't say whether you're going to see them together or separate, what would your preference be for a first session going in? Being that this is your first ever couple session?
My intuition is that I'd like to see them together, just especially because there's not a lot in their intake that they filled out. Mm-hmm. And I just want to see them sort of interact a bit.
Okay. Yeah. So that's completely viable. It's absolutely not a problem. The only and there's some benefits to it. So one of the benefits is that you have no bias coming in, right? When you mm-hmm. see them individually, you somewhat can have a bias, you know, let's say you see the male partner first, you have his opinions coming in, then you go in and see the other partner, you go into that with some bias, it's impossible not to have some bias. And then you go together and you have this like view of them mixed from both of their individual portions, right?
Right.
So the pro of seeing them together removes that bias, right? Yeah. So there isn't a right answer. First, okay. I'll start with that. There are people that work out of EFT, emotionally focused therapy, that do prefer to meet together first, then break them apart into individuals, and then come back together for sort of couples work, right? Then there's people like me included in that, that do like to meet with the partner separate, bearing in mind that there can be a bias. And so really, you know, honoring that and taking that into consideration. Mm-hmm. We go through a questionnaire with each of them. So there's some standardization with the guidance to the client that this is really, these questions are not meant to be structured in the sense that you kind of have to go from one to the next, and you kind of have to answer one at a time. The main goal of that first individual session with each of them is one, most important is to build that individual alliance, that individual attachment that you're going to have with both of them in, from that individual lens first before coming and joining the attachment as a couple and joining the couple together. Mm-hmm. The second goal of those individual sessions is to essentially give them the platform to talk about their view and to answer those questions, but to give them their view of what is working well in the relationship, what's not working well, what do they see as the main issue, what do they see is the thing that bothers them about their partner, and what their goal is for couples counseling. So a lot of these kinds of things, right? Like, what does it look like when you're fighting and then you're getting these differing views, right? Mm-hmm. Another more clinical goal is to kind of suss out if there is potential physical violence, physical abuse, any kind of manipulation, any kind of personality disorder issues, right. Any kind of severe mental illness. So that's one of the benefits that you get when you meet with them individually, right? Yeah. Of course you can't do that, right? When you're starting with them together, but again, mm-hmm. you can break them apart after. So that's not a problem, right? The last sort of benefit I think of seeing them separately, and again, this isn't about whether you see them separately first or see them separately after you meet, but this is more of the benefits of having an individual session, regardless of when it comes about, is really just getting a sense from each of them. This is more to assist you in knowing kind of how to frame what the issue is and getting that sense of, like, from the EFT lens, who is the pursuer, who is the withdrawer, and what does their cycle actually look like? And meeting them individually allows for that. And to add why see them individually first, that I prefer that, is when you see them together, which I do as well when clients ask for that. And generally when I see them together, I won't break them apart individually after, because I kind of already get all that information from that couple session. Is that when you see them individually first, you aren't getting that other bias of, okay, I'm getting the bias of this is what they are when they're together, right? And then when I go individually, now I have a bias around that, right? From couples to breaking apart, right? And also some couples are, if there is that physical violence or any kind of fear from their partner, it's very difficult now for them to, or the benefit of seeing them individually first, if there's any safety issues, you're weeding that out. And then you know how to approach the other person when you see them individually. Let's say if you saw the female partner first, her male partner is abusing her, there's physical violence or something like that, you might approach that second individual session differently. And when you approach them together, you might approach that differently than you would have if you had seen them together right away. So that's some of my thoughts around it. There's more, but yeah, any kind of thoughts or feedback around any of that?
No, I'm right now taking it in. So
yeah, and you'll be able to watch it back, of course, afterwards as well. Yeah.
I would definitely have to, I think I would probably have to try both to see which one I'm more comfortable
absolutely. With. Absolutely. Absolutely recommend that, is to see, to experiment and do everything under the sun, essentially, while you have supervision.
Right. Yeah. Thank you for bringing out the points that you laid out. I think it's like just good to know what to keep in mind going into whichever one I do end up going with.
Yeah, exactly. Now, when we book it in, like when I book it in, I'm generally letting people know, like the clients know the benefits of, of basically some of the benefits I talked about, but the benefits that are relating more to them, right? The benefits, for example, of, you know, getting to speak to your side of the issue, to build that individual alliance with your counselor, to, you know, weed out any potential, you know, bigger issues, right, that could come up. And really just to give you a platform to talk about whatever you want to talk about from that individual place, that space that you have with the counselor before going into couples counseling.
Right. If you were to do individual first, how would you break up that first session? Would it be 30-30-30 that you were saying? Or
so very good question. Yeah. So over the years, I've been able to reduce it to 30-30-30. When I first started, it was more 45-45, like sometimes a full session, right? Like depending on their availability. Mm-hmm. The downside of doing that is if you have from let's say week one, you've got one partner, then week two, you have another partner, week three, you see them together. A lot can happen in that time. And if there's any kind of crisis or anything like that, And remember, when you're bringing things up, you're opening a can of worms in a sense with each of them. That can sometimes increase the likelihood of them not actually beginning the couple's journey, right? And so that's an issue, right? So over the years, I've shortened that window down as much as possible, and I've at least the last 4 or 5 years, I've arrived at the 30-30-30, and that's kind of the best of both worlds in my mind, because you give them the platform. It's something, it's 30 minutes, it's not an hour or 50 minutes, right? And for most people, that's enough time. And for me, it's enough time to understand their side of things.
Right.
30 is a good amount of time.
Yeah.
And then the good thing about it too, is that for a lot of people, a 50 minute couple session, if they've never done couples counseling before, is really daunting. So So starting with a 30-minute, it's like a very light entry into EFT, right? Now, right. What you do in that 30 minutes can vary, but 30 versus 50 versus 80, which are kind of the three types that they could have, 30 is less, especially for, I'd say on average, more for the male client that's kind of pulled in by his wife, right? That kind of thing. They are not wanting, you know, to just jump and dive right in. This gives them a really light session, and it gives them a comparison of this is what 30 minutes feels like. Their next session might be 50. This is what 50 minutes feels like. And then going up to 80 minutes. Yeah. Right. I had a couple this week, and again, from the lens of EFT, you know, did the 30 the first session. She was sort of in the hot seat in that first 30 minutes of that, mm-hmm. of that first session. The second session, he was in the hot seat basically the whole time, the whole 50 minutes. And he said it felt like 15 minutes, right? And he did some really good work, you know, comes from, I won't get too into it, but very repressive kind of culture and family that doesn't talk about feelings, right? So him getting to talk about and feel his body in some way made the perception of time shrink so much. He said last session felt way longer, even though last session was like 30 minutes with her versus 50 minutes to that day with him. And he said that felt way longer, right? So perception of time changes depending on who's doing the enactments, who's doing the expressing.
Right.
Yeah.
In those sessions where you do the 30-30-30, what are you, like, I guess, what would be, like, the goals of those, like, individual sessions? Are you trying to figure out how they perceive the issue and then what goals they have for their relationship? Or do you ask about the relationship goals, like, in the group and when they come back together?
So to answer the last part, I ask for, and you can see, I can bring it up on the screen in a moment. Maybe that would be good. I'll do that in a second here, because that will partly answer your question as well. I'm just going to pull it up. Just give me 1 second here. So we've got
the couples form, right?
That's right.
Okay, let me get my...
I moved it into the professional development folder. There we go. Questionnaire for session. Okay, so I'll share my screen. Everyone can see. There you go. So can you see that?
Yep.
Okay, so part of it is to just get these questions answered. So the reason these questions are here is some of the, you know, information is important, right? It's not going to be important for all couples, but there's something in there that could be important for some couples, right? So how did you meet? That's really important, because I want to know if they have kind of the same story. Sometimes there's interesting background info, like, oh, we met, you know, he was with another person at the time, and you know, he cheated on that person with me. Okay, that's good to know, right? There's some history there. So something like that. And you might get that only from one of them and not from the other. So, you know, you get some information there from that. You know, this one is, you know, what was the first thing you liked about them? And then come up, you know, beyond just physical, like, what was the first thing you noticed? What do you, when you fast forward now, what do you most like about the relationship, you know, itself? And I contrast that from, like, if they're not sure what that means, you know, compared to previous relationship or compared to being single, right? What is it like right now to be in this relationship, right? And then to contrast that with now, what do you most like about your partner? Which is very different than this first question, right? This is what you initially first perceived that you liked about them. And then this is today, or overall in your whole relationship with them. At the top, I might write down, you know, how long they've been together. Do they have kids? Do they live together? How old their kids are? Some just kind of general information that they give me that's outside of these questions. And then in the A, I'll put in, you know, first partner's answer, and then B, second partner's answers. And let's see. So then now, of course, that naturally leads to what bothers you about your partner, right? What, from your perspective, is the main issue in the relationship? I should really change this to, because it's not just one, as we know, right? So what is the main issue or issues in the relationship? When do you think these began? Kind of, were they there from the beginning and they kind of evolved and kind of got worse over time? Did they start at a particular moment. So this is to suss out, is there an event in the relationship that kind of made things from then on turn into, you know, a negative trajectory when it was going really well, right? Sometimes health issues, you know, a pandemic might do that, you know, right. There's a lot of different things like that. And then of course, what are the kind of individual costs of these issues? So personality changes, like just severe trauma, pain, you know, anything that kind of changed who they are as a person, right? Mm-hmm. Close this window because I'm getting noises from it. There you go. Okay, so this one's interesting. I snuck this in because I thought this was really, I would get certain people giving me what needs to change. So I kind of threw that in there preemptively, like, so what do you think needs to happen in order to solve this problem? You know, again, all relating to what is the main issues.
Right.
So what do you think needs to happen? So I kind of like the answer of, you know what? I have no idea. That's the best answer, because I know that they're going to trust me to employ whatever modality or process that I have. Right. Now, when they say, okay, my partner needs to change X, Y, Z. Okay. I know I might get some resistance down the road. Hmm. So that's the purpose of that question for me. This one I took from Sue Johnson. Before this relationship, did you experience a safe, loving relationship with someone you trusted and could turn to if needed? And could you count on them? How did you let them know if you needed connection? Did they ever betray you? If no one was safe, how did you comfort yourself? It's like a obviously multi-barreled question here, but yeah. It's really good. You kind of ask one at a time, right?
Yeah.
You don't bombard them with this, right? I hope that's kind of obvious there. But yeah. This is really good to know, right? Like, did these issues start in this relationship? Did they start before? Like, what's the root in a sense of this? You get a little sneak peek into that. You don't need to write too much, but just kind of a sense. Now, back to today, do you feel safe and secure with your partner? I'll sometimes say, however you define that, right? Some people say, oh, like, do you mean physically or emotionally or whatever, right? So just say however you define it and let them define it. And then now in the past, with past partners. So these are three questions, right? Can you turn to your partner if you're feeling hurt or scared or feeling anything kind of vulnerable, right? So I ask this sometimes in two ways. So if I get a funny answer, I might say, okay, let's break this into two parts. So outside of this relationship, so like you come home, you had a really bad day at work, you know, you're really frustrated. Is this something you can turn to your partner about? And if they say yes, okay, now what about things within the relationship? Right? So you kind of break it down and see, is it really just with relational issues? Is everything? And then what do you do to cope? Mm-hmm. Do you keep it to yourself? Do you turn to your friends? Do you turn to family members, right? What do you do? Do you drink? Do you eat? Do you go and gamble online, right? So this one's really important. This is probably the most important question. How do you see yourself in the relationship in relation to your partner? Now, I ask this in different ways. So I don't actually ask it verbatim like this. I'll maybe say this and then I'll say, yeah, so, you know, if I'm a fly on the wall, or, you know, if you're being recorded, what would the camera see when there's an escalation, when things are not going well, right? What's your role? What's the other person's role? Like, just tell me step by step what that looks like, right? You're not looking for a story. You're looking for a pattern, right? Mm-hmm. This is really going to help illustrate the cycle for you, right? Any questions about this question? Because this one's really the most important one. And also to know, do they have any insight over the pattern as well? Like, where are they at with that? Or are they just completely oblivious to there being a pattern?
Right. Yeah, I like the way that you phrased it better than how it's written right now.
Yeah.
A little bit more clear about what you're trying to...
Yeah, I might change this as well,
yeah,
to make it a little clearer. Yeah. So now this one's more about abandonment. Have there been any moments in the relationship where, like, you really needed your partner and they weren't there
for you? So like attachment, right? Injuries.
Yeah, and it's so I break attachment injuries down into like betrayal and abandonment.
Okay.
Right. So abandonment is not a betrayal, right? It's very, yeah, you know, I was sick and he worked and I had a miscarriage and he wasn't there and just disappeared. These kinds of things.
Yeah.
These are abandonments, betrayal, you know, infidelity, Most of the time there's other betrayals, like physical abuse and things like that could be in betrayal. So those are kind of the two distinct kinds of attachment injuries. But yeah, you'll get that in there. Sometimes you'll get the more physical abuse kind of things here, right? Yeah, what's your goal for your sort of individual goal for the couples counseling, or your view of what the goal is for the relationship, right? Mm-hmm. Try to make this, you know, measurable as possible. You know, so that, you know, if we come back to this in a month, we know that it's achieved. If I ask the same question and I get a very ambiguous, vague answer to, you know, to this, then that goal isn't really helpful, right? So as an example, I want to have more sex. So how much sex are you having? So I'd ask, how much sex are you having right now? Say it's once a month. So twice a month is your goal then? Because that's more, right? Mm-hmm. So I know that it's probably more than just what you're saying, right? So do you have an idea of what the right amount of intimacy is? Is it a number? Is it a feeling? Like what, when you close your eyes, do you envision this being for you to feel, ah, I'm content with this. I'm happy. I'm ecstatic with this. This need is met. So then they might go, yeah, maybe it's not about the sex. Maybe it's about something else. Or maybe they go, okay, yeah. I think three times a week. Okay. That's very measurable. In a month, I can say, are you guys having sex three times a week? And if you're not, are you happy with the amount you are having? Because maybe it wasn't about the sex. Maybe it was about something else. And we maybe solved that. And now the sex doesn't matter. Right? So
yeah.
I like to come back to these goals once in a while. And whatever they are in the beginning, right? Like goals will evolve as awareness increases, as you achieve certain outcomes, right? Goals kind of change. And then of course you get that from both sides. Now, I'll come back to this in a moment. Now, what is your belief that this will work, right? Now, this one's kind of tricky to answer because we don't know what kind of exposure they have to EFT.
Mm-hmm.
So they might be only answering this based on just their connection with me so far, which is another reason I do like meeting individually first, right? Because I like to get that off the bat, right? Without the bias of that first session they had together with you, right?
Right.
And then motivational level, I might not ask this, I might just kind of notice it, but I might ask it if I'm not clear on that. So motivational level, the way I'll ask this one is, you know, so based on what I've said so far about EFT or meeting me and that kind of thing, what is your willingness to put in the work, to do the kind of homework, if there's homework in between sessions, to kind of take the emotional risks, these kinds of things, right? What's your emotional level, right? So right. Sometimes people will say, most of the time people say I'm 100%. Other times people say, well, if my partner does that, I'm also in, right? But yeah, this is important to know because you kind of, you know, if there's any attachment left in the relationship at all, sometimes gets to that when you ask it. One of the prerequisites for EFT is that we have some attachment left, right? If we have no attachment left, they're not in it for the relationship. They're in it for practical reasons, right? For mm-hmm. the kids or for something else. And they're not looking to actually have the goals that EFT has outlined to me, which is, right, de-escalate and connect.
Yeah.
Right? So if you want to have a strong bond, that then EFT is for you. If you don't, really EFT is not for you. Maybe Gottman or maybe something else is better for you.
Right.
Or just EFT up to the end of stage one is for you. And then stage two, you don't need.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Or yeah, that's very, very rare, I would say, like 1 in 1,000, to be honest with you, that you'll get something like that. Because most people come in and they're wanting to work on the relationship, right?
Right.
And they're wanting to work because there's some attachment left. If there wasn't, usually they're out, I would say. So now back to the, what is your belief that this will work? So because I do the 30-30-30 with almost everyone, if they don't have exposure to EFT, I won't talk to them about EFT in that individual portion. I'll say, okay, you don't know about it. I work out this model called EFT. Do you want some, do you have any questions about it now? Or Would it be okay that I talk to both of you just for the sake of time, and I'll be repeating the same information twice otherwise, right? And almost always it's yeah. Let's you know, talk to us about it after. Okay. And so yeah, then yeah, the answer to that's not that important, right? And this is important. Anything that you know you wanted to share that you didn't get to share based on the questions that I'm asking you. So that's what that's for, right? Just to make sure that they feel really, really heard around that. And then this part is really about consent to share with their partner. If the answer to this is no, then we keep it between them and me.
I was actually going to ask you about like a no secrets policy, and how you felt about that, but I guess you just, you would address it like there.
It really depends.
Okay.
So there are times where it's important to bring up what they're hiding, right? Mm-hmm. But it's also, to me, a lot more important for them to decide on when that is and how that is, right?
Okay.
And if that is.
Right.
So I'll say almost always it comes out anyways in therapy.
Okay.
One way or another.
Okay.
It's going to come out. I don't want to potentially disrupt my relationship with this individual right off the bat when I just met them 30 minutes ago. I actually want to, this question's meant to strengthen it.
Right.
And actually this reinforces what I do in the consent form, which is I'll do the, when I have the 30-30-30, I'll actually do the consent form with both of them there first, then break them up. And I'll say, right. Everything we talk about remains in this room, and without your written consent, I can't even divulge what you reveal in the individual portion to your partner unless you're okay with that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Or, of course, unless there's severe safety concerns, right?
And then that's right. Different. Limits to confidentiality. Yeah. Like.
That's right. That's right. So I even say that to both of them before they talk, and then I reinforce that here with at the end of their individual portion. They're both very, very important. In my right. opinion, they're extremely, extremely important. It's really a very quick way to build rapport and to build trust and to make the likelihood of that attachment to be as strong as possible, as quickly as possible, right? I didn't mention this, but one of the main goals of both the individual sessions and all the way through all the couple sessions is to make both sides feel like the client is their relationship. Even in the individual session, the client is always the relationship. That's what they're here for. They're looking to improve their interpersonal connection and their interpersonal relationship, not their individual relationship with themselves or their relationship with me or any of that. It's just about the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the first 30 minutes here, we're kind of saying, and with this question, we're kind of saying, you are very, like, you are all that matters, right? Which is what we do in individual counseling, right? But so that's why there are exceptions to the no secret, or I'm saying to all secrets are okay policy, right?
Right.
The exceptions are when it really can harm the relationship. So it depends on, because there's no black and white around anything like
right. that, right? Yeah. So how would, you said you don't break up back into individuals once you come back together?
That's also it's not that I don't, it has happened. There are times that the call for it, but the default is to not do that, yeah.
What would be cases where you do break into individuals again?
So safety concerns. There are times, the most common I would say is when they both request it and they're both okay with it.
Okay.
And there's ground rules and things like that around it, right? Like, most of the time we'll have to balance out the session, meaning right. I have to see both of you and the client is still the relationship. Like it right. needs to still be very clear, but that we're like taking a detour to learn a little bit about maybe blocks that you're having that you're not able to work on in couples counseling, and that in individual counseling, and also it's generally a one-off, so it's not multiple sessions, it's a one session, and then we're back together or concurrently, like in the same week I might see one partner and them together.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's rare. So I mean, for this particular discussion, it's not worth having, I think, because it's more of like an intro discussion. I would say it's like very, very rare. 95% of the time, I will usually say it's not a good idea. And it's also more of an advanced thing, because a lot, even in times where I've done it, I had regretted doing it. Mm. Yeah. And I've not always regretted doing it, but there have been times where I've regretted doing it, because it's impossible for it to not impact the couple's dynamic, right? Yeah. By that, I mean, not the couples themselves, but the three of us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even if we do all the things and balance, and I see both of them, it can impact the dynamic, because now you're working on different things.
Yeah.
And then having to remember what we talked about, individual versus couples, and their perception of how they see me as their ally, and I'm on their side now, can change, and what they talk about amongst themselves about our about their individual sessions and their perception of their individual sessions and what I thought about their individual sessions based on what I had said, and we weren't all there.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I would say, try not to do it.
Okay.
And explain to them why. Explain to them why. Because there's been really even very, really good individual counselors that have been working for years that then I talk to that ask me, oh, what's the problem? And then they do it. And then I dissuade them from, I tell them why I don't think it's a good idea. They do it. And they're like, oh, even after I tell them the reason, then after they come back to me, oh, okay, now I get it. Now I get why, four sessions into it, I understand why it's not a good idea.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, it's, I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying it's challenging, or things can come up out of your control. So I'll just kind of leave it at that. Yeah.
No, I just wanted to know like when it would happen. Cause I feel like I would feel uncomfortable doing it, especially just now, like going into it.
Yeah. Yeah. So go with that. And I think you have to be really comfortable if you're going to do that.
Okay.
Yeah. And same goes for, or similarly goes for shifting from a client you've seen individually into couples work.
Yeah. I had a few like individual clients that had asked, and I told them that I'm not sure if that would be a good idea. And then. Yeah,
it's not impossible. And I've done it successfully many, many times.
Right.
Kind of easier guidelines around that is if you've seen someone more than two times,
mm-hmm.
then it becomes more challenging to switch over to couples counseling.
Yeah.
But if it's two or less, then you essentially just think of that second session as, think of the first session as your introductory session.
Right.
Think of the second session as learning about that couple relationship dynamic. And then you bring in the partner, and then you've had one session with both.
Right.
And it can balance it out, right?
Right.
You know, three sessions might be okay. It really depends on how deep you went in those sessions, right?
Yeah.
You know, four sessions even might be okay. But you know, the longer, the more likely that's going to interfere with the couple's dynamic. And also the partner might have issues with it. Like, hey, that was your individual counselor.
Yeah,
they're gonna take your side. So it really also depends on the couple, and then that individual loses you as an individual counselor.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So there's things there, right? That you have to keep in mind. And then there's so many unknowns that until you do it, you won't even realize that may come up. You know, many sessions down the road.
Right.
Yeah. Good. So we got about, I'm actually, just so you know, I am able to go past 11 if you want to. I can go maybe to 11:15. So it's up to you.
Okay.
And but yeah, let me know. So it's 10:40 right now. So we have at least 20 minutes. Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to ask, when you bring them, like, I won't have time this week or with this couple to do the 30-30-30. But let's say like next couple I do. Mm-hmm. When you bring them back in together,
mm-hmm.
What are the questions that you go through then if these are for like individuals?
Yeah. Yeah, I actually don't go through any questions, right?
Okay.
One thing I do is I try to come up with, I read out both of their goals that they came up with, right? For couples counseling, and I try mm-hmm. to create unified language. I do read that part out to both of them. It's like, this is yours. Does that sound right? Has anything changed? Do you like to add anything? And then this is what you said. And then let's come up with unified language. Sometimes I'll just say, how does this sound? Because this and this look the same. Does this sound like it covers both sides? And maybe you look at it ahead of time and actually you come up with unified language so that you don't have to think about it on the spot.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're doing 30, 30, 30, you might not have time to do that. Yeah. And often for the first 30, I don't bring it up. I do it the next session.
Okay.
The most important thing for me in that 30 minutes is that they walk away with an experience. And that experience being that it is different than what they normally experience with each other. And it's on the path of their goal, the path of de-escalating, the path of connecting. They need to have an experiential moment that is aligned with what they want, right? So generally speaking, that means one enactment, processing that enactment, and having the receiving partner enact back, and then processing the first partner's experience of hearing what their partner just said, and then zooming out and being able to sort of tie a bow around what just happened.
So you do that in the first, like that first 30?
That's the most important thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And with time, and I don't mean to say that to create pressure of any kind, but when you go through the EFT training, the main thing you learn is always be enacting, like always do an enactment. Every session needs to have at least one.
Right.
The reason is, and there's always something to enact, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's no too little of an enactment unless you're literally not talking about the relationship. Anything you talk about can be enacted. It doesn't matter how abstract, superficial it might be,
mm-hmm.
because by looking at each other's face and being able to say something in a way that's different than how they're used to saying it, while there's some emotion felt in their body or yeah. some attention given to their body for them to feel what it is they're saying with congruence, is going to be a different experience. Now, if they're not in their body, you can still enact them. Let's say all you got to in that 30 minutes was, and it's let's say 20 minutes into that last 30 minutes, and all they've said is, yeah, when she does this, I just want to run away. Okay, that's a good start. That there's emotion, there's some emotion underneath what's driving that behavior. Can you look at her and tell her that when you say this, I think to myself, uh-oh, and I just want to run. And that's different than what he would do, right? What would he actually do in real life? He would run. And now he's stopping and saying, I think of running and it makes me want to run. That's different. That's standing there, feeling what he's feeling something, and essentially owning up, being accountable for his response. And that's different.
Yeah.
And gives the partner insight that's different than seeing him run. Seeing him run is going to be a trigger for her. Seeing him right. say it makes him want to run, maybe that's different right. of an experience for her. And then that might be enlightening for her and have her go from the belief that he chooses to run to recognizing the reality, which is that he's triggered, and when he's triggered, automatically he wants to run.
Yeah.
Right? Very different. Maybe subtle, but it could land very different for him.
Yeah.
Yeah. So your first session's tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
one option, if you do want to meet them individually, you could, you could, this is not out of bounds. You can call them up and say, hey, I just had supervision with my, you know, supervisor about your case. And he suggested that I meet with both of you individually first before meeting together. What would it be like to, instead of doing the hour together, doing 30 minutes with each of you separately? And here are some of the reasons. If you're not comfortable with that, we can absolutely go, you know, meet together, just like originally planned. But if you do think there's value to that, then I'm happy to meet with both of you separately first.
Right. Okay.
You can put that in an email. You can call them up. What do you think about that?
I would, my first question was which partner I would talk to.
Which one first? Or which one on the phone?
Because I only have one phone number. And then I have both emails. So if I do it by email, I could just email them both.
Yeah. I'm looking at, so you don't have you have a 6 o'clock right after, right?
Yeah, I do. So
we would have 30 is not possible, but 30 is possible. And still, in my opinion, more beneficial than seeing them together. Not more beneficial, but there's value to that I think would assist.
Yeah.
And then actually make it easier for you to come in with having some background information to the first session. Actually, it'd actually be the best for you because you're not doing a couple session then tomorrow. You're just doing two individual.
Right. It'd be a little easier to go into then. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I only say to call because it's tomorrow and they might not get their email.
They
won't get an email. Yeah. Yeah. But if you do want to put it in an email, you can always just propose it and say, hey, you know what? Either one's okay. Here's some of the benefits of splitting up and doing 30-30, right? Some of the benefits we talked about today. But it's completely your choice.
Right.
And then they can let you know before the session or they can let you know right at the session.
If I were to call, again, just because I only have that one number, would I be just talking with whoever picks up or...
Yeah, and then just say, hey, you know what? Just like you'd be emailing, say, yeah, these are some of the benefits. Do you want to talk to your partner and see which one works better for you?
Okay.
I'll tell you. Go ahead.
I was going to say I wouldn't ask to speak to the other partner as well.
Okay. No, they can talk to their partner. Okay. I mean, you can if you want, but yeah, it's just faster that way. And considering it's only a day away, right?
Yeah.
What was I going to say there? My typical response would be whatever you think is best.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's all about your delivery. It's all, you're not really selling anything. I truly believe meeting individually is better. And so it's if you believe that, you just saying, hey, you know, this is my recommendation, or here are the three reasons. Do any of these seem like they'd be valuable to you? And if so, you know, would you want to meet individually first before next week we could be having our first couples session together?
Right.
Yeah.
With the 30-30, how would you wrap up the session at the end?
Because think about it more of, like I said, there's different reasons. But one of the reasons it's an information extracting exercise, right?
Yeah.
It's an assessment of sorts, right?
Yeah.
And so... you can have them come back and say, thank you for your time. You know, if the other one has to go, then it's okay. You're just wrapping up. You'll wrap up it to individual. Thank you. It was really nice meeting you. I'm really looking forward next time to kind of working with both of you together, and then do the same thing with the other individual.
Okay. I was a little bit, I was just in my head, I guess, about like ending the session. One person.
Yeah. You've never done it before, and you know, all the kind of questions come up, you know, when you're kind of worried about how things go and wanting to have all the answers. There's nothing to really overthink too much. It's just a natural conclusion, right?
Right.
To an individual session, the session's just shorter.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think I had one question. Oh yeah, I had a question about the questionnaire. Mm-hmm. Do you normally get through the questionnaire for the most part in the 30 minutes?
Believe it or not, most of the time I do. I don't want to be sexist here, so I won't be. But when there are, when I notice that they really need to be heard around certain issues, mm-hmm. And that it's going to take longer, I give them mm-hmm. the time to go into that. And if it seems important and that they need it, absolutely. And then I might just ask less questions. I'll write down whatever they say, put it in the question, in the answers that they should go into. And whatever I don't get, I don't get. As long as I get the answer of like, what is your goal for couples counseling? That's the most important one as far as needing to continue. When they don't need an answer, they're just storytelling. It's not like to give me information that I don't need. In those cases, I'll usually try to focus them a little bit and kind of go right to the next question. Yeah.
Okay.
Now, when the information that they're giving is really important and, you know, it's necessary, and I do think it'll need more time, I see it taking more, then it's challenging. Then I kind of will say at the 30-minute mark, hey, you know what? We're at 30 minutes. We kind of need to be switching. At the same time, I think what you're saying is really important. So what would it be like for today? We'll do 45-45 instead of 30-30. I'd leave it up to them.
Right.
And you might have to do that the first couple of times as you get good at just kind of extracting the information that you need.
Right.
And the other, and then we kind of need to let the partner know so that they're not like in the waiting room or whatever. So we kind of have to let them know as well that it's we're to make it balanced and fair, we're going to go 45-45 today. Is that okay? Like your partner needs some more time.
Right.
And I've never had an issue with that. Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Again, it's not ideal because we don't get that experience, but they get the experience of really feeling like we heard more of their experience than if we only spent 30 minutes with them.
Right. All right. Sorry, I'm just trying to take everything in right now.
Absolutely. No, take your time. Yeah. So you're going into your first session tomorrow. Yeah. What comes up as a worry or that you're wanting to address before your first ever couple session?
Yeah, I think my biggest worry is especially in like individuals, I let the client lead a lot. Or I try to let the client lead as much as possible, but in a couple's situation, I mean, not if we're doing like the individual intakes, but in a couple situation, like I definitely need to be able to balance that out. And so I don't know, I'm just worried. I don't know like what's going to happen.
Right? Absolutely.
I've never had that.
I hear you, and I'm, you know, as you know, I'm a very person-centered individual counselor. So for me, it was scary at first as well, but it's actually a very natural transition, and maybe Byron can talk about his experience around that, like how he felt beforehand versus after, because for me, the first session was like 9 years ago, so it's hard to remember, but for what my sense is that the transition is natural because it's what the client wants of you, the client being the relationship.
Right.
And you'll get to experience that in the moment with a couple when they're both there, you know. And think about it as one example. You're working with one person, you're looking this way, right? And you notice in the side of your peripheral vision, the other client, even if they're very polite and very nice and not interrupting, which is not the norm. You know, the norm is some kind of, you see something, but you notice something.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so there's energy coming at you like I want something.
Mm-hmm.
Right, whereas an individual that won't happen.
Yeah,
it's got your client, so it's like you kind of have to attend to whatever's in the room. Right, that doesn't mean that you don't have a plan, and that you're like, if you're working with one in that moment, that you're not going to be able to say something or to stay with them. You may just say, hey, you know, I see that you are having a hard time right now with what's coming up. You know, can you bear with me just like 5 minutes, and I think we'll be able to wrap this part up and then come back to you. Or hey, I could see this is challenging. What's coming up for you right now? Right, like it depends. Right. Yeah. But yeah, it's so this balancing act for sure. The sometimes referee act. But yeah, Byron, can you share your experience around that?
Yeah. So I was similar to you, Jonathan. Like I like to give the clients the lead and see where they want to go. And so I had a hard time balancing that out with my couple because they were like really, really contentious. And I felt the first session just like slice, just slipping away. Like it was just out of control. It was so hard to kind of bring
Jonathan,
back
did
in.
You, Jonathan, did you hear? Not contentious. Not really contentious, really, really contentious, which is not the norm.
Right. Yeah. So I don't want to spook you because this is my only experience, but I was surprised how much I had to really insert myself. I'm not used to that in my one-on-ones where, you know, I can kind of let them. And if I see them kind of trailing off, I can kind of jump in. This is like with two people really going back and forth. And so I think it's really good early on to kind of set some expectations, as far as the dynamic and how you're going to insert yourself and cut off at different points. And you're not saying what they have to say isn't important. You just say, oh, you know, we only have this very precious amount of time here. And so we want to make the most of it. And so, you know, I'm going to have to jump in here. I'm going to have to cut you off. I know you're going somewhere that's really important right now, but I just for the sake of time, so we can kind of stay on top of this, I'm just going to focus on this one thing that you said. So that was, I was a little shocked how much I had to push that in. And like Ofir was saying, like, you're going to notice if one person's going on for a bit, the other one's going to start to kind of sit on pins and needles, and you're going to see them start to shift their weight and make head movements, hand movements. And just like Ofir said, just make sure you acknowledge it somehow, like just like maybe just kind of gesture and nod, but if the other person is going on too much, or, and I don't want to say too much, but if they're start, because one issue with my couple is she has so many things, so she'll start with one and then she'll try and stitch it to another. And so, and I think that's how a lot of people work that have a lot to say. And so maybe just trying to find those intervals. So if you do feel like there's a small little interval where she's trying to, where they are trying to stitch in another issue or an idea, just jump in there and just cut them off. And that's one thing that Sue Johnson does a lot, is she really jumps in a lot, and she's very, very like integrated. Whereas I tend to sit back a little more and kind of take it in. She's like inside their conversations. And so, there's a bit of a paradigm that you have to kind of shift a little bit as far as how much you insert yourself. And it'll be definitely a learning curve, because it took a couple sessions for me to get confident and be like, oh, where he or she is going off and really passionate, I can get in there. I can kind of temper it. I can kind of find some natural spots to kind of jump in and wow. De-escalate.
That's amazing. Great points, and great to hear that you're getting confident in doing that, because that's a skill that you'll never master, because every couple is so different and you have to know what will work for that unique individual within that dynamic that will, I don't want to say appease them, but I want to use sort of the, that will actually validate them, to allow them to kind of diffuse and calm, and as you said, pins and needles, so really just settle in their chair, right? Because you really don't want to, it's very important to be balanced, in the sense that you don't want to have one partner feel like the other partner's getting all the attention, the work is all done on them, because remember, the couple is the client, right? Their relationship is the client. So even as far as risk taking, meaning vulnerability doing, right? And you want it to be balanced as well. You don't want to just have the same person be expressing every session. Not that you have to count back and forth, although that could be helpful in the beginning. So, okay, you were the actor last time. You're gonna be in the hot seat this time. Sometimes I will make jokes about that. If they're receptive to jokes. That is. Keep that in mind. It's a balancing act in a sense, because you are not working with one person, right? You are really all, you know, like visually, I even see it. I'm never working with one person, right? I'm always working with both of them. Like it's like a hug, right? I kind of visualize I'm hugging both of them. If there's two people in the room, you never have a group hug with one person, right? It breaks the definition, right?
Yeah.
You're hugging both of them. And when I'm working with one person, I'm hugging this person while I'm also hugging this person. And when I'm hugging this person, I'm also hugging this person, but I've got more of my attention at this person.
Right.
So it's kind of how I see it, right? But yeah, referencing Sue is great because Sue is obviously the master, but she does some things that I could never do, right? Like, for example, I can't do a British accent, right? Which there's some value to that, right? Very non-threatening. but two, like the touching, you know, I can't do the touching that she does.
Right.
Right. I do touching once in a while, but it's not like her. Right. You know, and obviously I'm not saying you need to touch your clients like Sue or anything like that, but it's the message she sends with the touching. Like Byron says, she's integrated. So to me, that means she's doing it. She's very aware of what she's doing. She's letting the other person that you're not attending to know that they matter, that they are part of this dynamic, that they're whatever their issue that they have in that moment that's being triggered, that they want to speak up or that they are triggered in that moment, that it will be addressed, that you see it, that it's never going to not come up. At some point, it may not come up right now, right? But the fact that you see it and that it's important, that you're going to get to it, is I'm not saying it's going to be believed by the person, but that's the message you're sending. And you need to follow up with that as well.
I think that's a good distinction to make.
Yeah,
like not have to prove yourself in the moment.
Right, that's right. Yeah, and over time, it will be proven because you will come back to them. They will get addressed, right? But in the first session, it might not be, right?
Yeah.
So in those cases where you do have a client like Byron, you need to front load sometimes and be more proactive around it and letting them know that, you know what, in this model, we do sometimes work with one person for a little bit and then we do an enactment and then we come back to the other person. And so when we're working with one person, think of it this way, like if they like this analogy, we're working underneath the hood and we're looking at what the problem is. And until we get to the root of it, that being emotion and that being, you know, this model of being called emotionally focused therapy, and we're focusing on emotions, but specifically primary emotions,
right.
Vulnerable emotion, right? As opposed to indirect secondary emotions, right? This is the language of the model, right?
Yeah.
Until we hit those, we really want to kind of dig for them. And sometimes I'll say in that digging process, in that under the hood investigative process, we need to spend a little time. And it's abstract at first, so it won't be primary. It won't be indirect, or it won't be direct. It will be indirect at first. And that could be triggering. And I'm very aware that it's going to be triggering. And, you know, we will get to the things that triggered you. But I want you to also trust me that where we're going, you will get more value from staying with it than by us addressing what's coming up for you right now in this moment. We will address it, but in this moment. So there's different ways of explaining that. That's like the overarching principle.
Right.
And Sue will just touch their knee and say, I'm right here for you. I'm right here with you. And I'll be right back. And that works. And it's the same thing, right? So different things will work for different people.
Yeah. I think that's a really good point just to have that front loaded.
Yeah.
I was going to ask, because my client that I'm seeing is like through Zoom. What are some big changes between like a online session versus a... like in-person session that I should be aware of?
That could be a 2-hour call right there. The reason I tell all my couples in these days that if you can, if you're able to do in-person for couples work specifically, I won't get into individual work. It's still better in person, but Zoom's a good substitute for that. But for couples work, I do recommend it.
Okay.
So if you can make it in person, have it in person, right? That said, there are some tools that we can utilize technically that will make it as good as it can be, right? Mm-hmm. So I've done, I'm lucky I have been doing online couples sessions from 2013, right? I've even done a couple session where one partner is in like one part of the world, the other partner's in another part of the world, right? So all three of us are in different places, right?
Right.
So with that, it's a bit more complicated, but they're in the same room. We'll just kind of address that question, but it's online. So there's some things you can't get away from, which is why in person's better. And that presence piece of like the peripheral vision part of seeing and feeling what's going on for that partner that you're not working with, that awareness of that is not as good. And of course, the more importantly, the ability to soothe them is not as good, because I can't put my hand and touch them, their knee, for example, if, you know, I'm non-person. But not only the touching part, I can't give them my attention in the way that I can. And it's all about what, right?
Turn to them, right?
Right. You know, not in the same way.
Yeah.
Right. But what I do, so with Zoom, I try to look at the camera. That's really important to mimic that right brain to right brain behavior, the eye contact, right? Mm-hmm. So right now, I like me and you, I'm not looking right at the camera, right? Mm-hmm. But what I do with my couples, I'm not even able to do that now because we're recording. But I minimize the window, right? So that the window comes as close to the top as possible.
Right.
So that now I'm looking at you like that.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm not at all, I'm not looking at the camera. I'm looking right below, but the box becomes like this small and it's right up here.
Yeah.
So then it mimics that. So that's like one little tip.
Yeah.
A lot of the, of course, you want to make sure the bandwidth and the quality is as good as possible, that there isn't a lot of noise. You want to account for all that as much as possible, if possible, right? Any of that stuff's obviously going to impact the quality of the connection and the relationship, right? Figuratively and literally, right? And so some things, like I try to orient them in a way where they have the, like, in your own space, you create the space, you know, in terms of the chairs and everything else. When they're in their own home, you don't have control over that. But what you can do, you say, hey, you know what? Like if we were here, hey, can you move back a little bit, right? Hey, can you turn to your partner when you're doing the enactments, right? So you kind of have enough distance from each other as well, right?
Right.
So you can do stuff like that. Yeah.
Like make them sort of like restructure where they are, even if
that's right, if possible, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So things like that, I think that you can kind of try to replicate as much as possible, right? Like I was saying, if they're in different places, sometimes it'll mean things like, can you double click your partner's screen so that they're full screen while I'm a tiny screen, right? Can you do that while you're doing the enactment? Okay, and now come back to me. So then it's just a little bit more step by step. And again, of course, it can come across more artificial and all that kind of stuff. And you can laugh about it and you can, do that. And you know, it is what it is, right? This is the future and this is, or the present now. But in rural, like if you're working with someone in Nunavut and there's no therapist, no couples therapist that does EFT there and they want to do that, you don't have any other option.
Yeah.
So I'll say that, there's of course pros and cons. Like the accessibility is the pro, the cons are obvious. I'll say that it could be just as effective. It might just take a little bit longer. That's sort of the short of it. Because it's still real. It's video, audio. They're still there together.
Right.
You're still able to see everything that they're doing.
Yeah.
80%, whereas for individual counseling it's like 96% replicable.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's just good to know. Thanks for just going through that really quickly.
Yeah. And it's good. You'll get to experience both. I highly recommend you experience in-person couples work, remote couples work, definitely not phone. I've done that. Don't recommend that.
Okay.
A lot of my consults with couples are over the phone, right?
Yeah.
And even there, there's a gap of sorts, a gap of, it makes it very cognitive, I would say, right? The audio, it's great for podcasts, don't get me wrong, but for couples counseling where you're trying to engage with someone else, and it's fine for consults because, you know, they're both on the phone, I'm on the phone, they want to ask me questions about what EFT is. That's fine, right? But building a connection and getting deeper, there's a limitation of just using audio. And it's just the visual is pretty important.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, yeah. Don't get me wrong. You can get a lot of nonverbals from someone's voice. You just can't get everything.
Yeah.
But great question. Yeah.
I had one little bit of advice or just something that helped me. Cause like early on, it was really all about trying to get my confidence to like a healthy place where I could go in there and just be like really present and calm. And I found, I don't know if you've started reading it yet, but like just, or if you've already read it, maybe you have the Hold Me Tight book. I found just like reading an hour or listening to an hour of it, like before, would kind of help me get in the zone and kind of get me in that kind of relational flow. She does such a good job at just kind of describing all these core issues that come out and how it's such a pattern in almost every relationship. Yeah. And I don't know, for me, that was something that was really helpful. It was just kind of getting my brain into it and listening and reading some of that book beforehand kind of helps.
Which book are you talking about?
Hold Me Tight.
Oh, Hold Me Tight. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Hold Me Tight is such a great experiential book. It'll get you in that experiential plane. Not so much with the like these kinds of books. I mean, I love it, but can you see this one? Oh, it's blurring.
It's
it.
All blurred out, yeah.
There you go. Can you see that? Well, anyways, it's her manual, right? The Practice of Emotionally Focused Couples Therapy, right? This is the third edition that came out last year. I wouldn't read that right before because that'll get you in your head because you're learning the play by play of what EFT is, right? But you're going to maybe measure that versus what you want to do. And it's not, EFT is about being present. It's about connecting to your client, which means connecting to both of them and connecting to the relationship. So I wouldn't get technical. I wouldn't read technical stuff. So watch videos, watch or listen to Hold Me Tight. Those are very good experiential books because Hold Me Tight is written for couples. It's not written for therapists.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. But on the weekend, when you have time, you're not seeing a couple and it's at your own pace, then by all means, read the technical stuff.
Right.
Just not right before the session.
Yeah.
It might work for some people, just not for me.
No, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. And all her other books, like Attachment Theory and Practice is good. I just got the EFIT book. I haven't started it yet, but that's on my reading list. Love Sense is good.
I went through an attachment process in couple and family therapy. It's pretty heady.
which one, the Attachment Theory and Practice?
Attachment processes and couples and family therapy.
That's different. Yeah. No. So yeah, this is by Sue Johnson.
Yeah. This is right. This is a Sue Johnson.
Is it the one that came out last year?
No. This one is a little bit older.
Yeah. So that's a different book. Yeah. So that one is technical. I don't think I've read that one. But if this one's called Attachment Theory in Practice, that one's not too technical.
Okay.
That's a good intro book. Yeah. It's a good intro book because it talks about family, couples, individuals. And it simplifies EFT.
Okay.
It simplifies it to a five-step process versus the nine-step, three-stage process that the manual talks about.
Yeah.
Now, it doesn't include everything that the manual does, so you are losing something, but it's a good introduction. I really, really the metaphor of like doing the same five steps over and over and over as you move along with stages. It essentially intuitively is what EFT already is. It's just making it explicit.
Mm.
Yeah. That's how I was like, oh, I'm already doing this. This is essentially what my first kind of thought was as I was reading it.
Right. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to pick this up.
Yeah. But yeah, any other kind of last questions before we close out?
No, I think that's it. For now, I'm sure I'll have like a ton of questions afterwards.
Yeah. And I encourage you, you know, if you end up doing that individual part, I'm sure tons of questions will come up. And then, yeah, set up another time to you know, I'd love to record another one of these. And I'm sure a lot of people will get a lot of benefit, especially given that it's like really being broken up from like, this is before you saw anyone. This is just a student exposed to individual work, but not exposed to any couples work other than like concepts, right? Yeah. And then after they meet initially and all these you have the experience, so it'll capture that, and then all the kind of new questions that'll arise out of that. That's pretty cool. So I gotta let my dog in because he's gonna like start barking. So we can set up another one, ideally before you end up seeing them together.
Yeah.
I mean, you might see them together tomorrow, but either way, we can set up another supervision after that.
Alrighty. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. You're still okay with this going on YouTube after we've gone through it?
Yeah, I'm fine. I mean, right. I don't think there's anything that came up. I mean, I'm still learning and I'm totally okay with it.
Good. Yeah, no, I appreciate that a lot. I think a lot of people will benefit from this as well. Just anyone that's in the field that wants to be exposed to couples counseling. Like we have counselors like Ariel, actually, maybe I shouldn't talk about her here, but we have counselors, I'll say, that had always been interested in couples work and then just didn't have the exposure for whatever reason in the practicum. And now they've been practicing for 5 years or more. And they're like it's just too daunting. You know, I'm okay. I'm happy just doing individual work. Right. And they're like, oh, but if I could go back and do it all over again, I would have loved it. When I had the supervision, I would have loved to start doing couples work. Right. So imagine how many people there are. If they did have the exposure, we'd have way more couples kind of family counselors than we do now. And it's there's a huge shortage in the field. I think only about 25-30% of counselors do couples work.
Okay, wow.
And only a percentage of them do EFT, right? Like,
right.
Which to me is obviously unbiased is the most effective couples modality out there. But the research also says that. So hashtag facts.
Yeah, thank you for going over a little bit than the hour, but
no problem. So thank you as well. And I'll send out the link for everyone once it's up and ready to go. And thanks again. Yeah, let me know when you want to do it again.
All right.
And thanks, Byron, as well for participating.
Thanks
for your input, guys. Too. That's fine.
It was good to hear Byron's like side of things, just him going through.
Exactly. It was 3 weeks ago that you were in Jonathan's shoes, a month ago, maybe?
Just under a month ago. So
there you go.
It's exciting to take it in.
I'm excited for you, Jonathan. I know it's scary, but I'm excited for that feeling you get. It's like that first high. The difference between this high and a drug high is that you do get to experience it again, even after 10 years. I haven't been practicing 10 years, but yeah, after 8 years, you still feel it, you know, each time. Yeah. It doesn't go away. It's a healthy high. Awesome. We'll call it that.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right. All right. Thanks, everyone. Yeah. All right. We'll see you next time.
All right.
See you guys.
Take care. Bye.